for digital marketing campaign. And I'm happy that I have Joe from Hulu and Blake from the Trade Desk, who are two partners that are leading the connected TV space right now. A little background about Poynet. I'm on the programmatic team, but I work really closely with the search, social, and SEO team as well to create a holistic marketing program for clients. Now I want to talk about what connected TV is today. The main difference between connected TV and traditional TV, or let me back up. So connected TV is any device that you use to watch your TV show. So you can use your phone, your iPod, your desktop, or you can also use a smart TV like Roku or an Apple TV to stream any shows that you want to watch. But on the marketing side of things, the main difference for us when you're advertising on connected TV is you're able to layer on audience data because it is being streamed through an IP address, and that's what makes it so powerful. And with the ability to target your audience, you're able to focus on targeting an individual and not targeting a full household. Back in the day, everyone that was served a TV ad received it in the household, whether that be for a refrigerator. And even the daughter or son would get that same commercial who is a millennial and who's younger and who's not the decision maker of the household. But now with connected TV, since we can focus on the user and we know characteristics about them, we can actually target the decision maker or mother of the household who's actually in market to buy a refrigerator. What's also really powerful is you're able to create a user experience based on how they're interacting with your message or brand. For example, user A, we serve them a video, they decide to skip it as they're watching ESPN. So then we show them a different message with a different video on CNN. This time they watch 3/4 of the video. So that shows more engagement than the very first touch where they skipped through the entire video. So we decide to keep them engaged and serve them an online radio, a radio on Spotify. And this experience is different than user B, who actually decided to not skip the ad, watch the full advertisement, and we as advertisers are able to leverage that data and then target them with a native ad on their mobile phone. And after that, we can target them again with a banner ad. Connected TV in its purest form is video. And the main objective of video is to engage users. So it's still a top of funnel tactic. The main objective is to drive awareness, consideration of your product, but it's also to create a user experience despite what device your user is engaging or watching their content on. And lastly, since connected TV is being streamed through an IP address, we're able to measure engagement. And with that, I will pass it on to Joe from Hulu.
Oh, a little guest appearance. Awesome. So I'm Claire Lasher. I'm a local account executive on the PAC Northwest.
And I'm Joe Hatagua. I am the West Coast lead for our advanced TV or programmatic offering at Hulu.
So I'll be quickly going over just some top line information on the media landscape, Hulu's platform and audience, and then I'll pass it over to this savvy specialist on programmatic offerings on Hulu. So just looking at a 5-year trend of the media landscape, you'll see, hopefully,
your computer's
awesome. So over a 5-year trend, you'll see that TV ratings are consistently declining, which makes the optimal market penetration harder to achieve. But simultaneously, you're seeing connected devices, ratings, viewership, consumption increase, which is why connected TVs can really be a great way to enhance that market reach, especially as it becomes a more normative behavior. And then as connected devices increase, we're also seeing streaming video on demand increase as well. So to no huge surprise, we see that millennials are at 76%, the highest group there. But I think it's important to note that the older groups, Gen X and baby boomers, also see consistent increase with streaming. And that is because it's becoming more accessible with connected TVs and streaming in general. And that's where a lot of these new content shows are coming from. And Hulu's seeing that same trend. So we're seeing almost 80% of those streams now happen on connected TVs, with less happening on desktops, computers, laptops. And I really think that benefit there is that we still now offer that same targeting that we had on desktop, but now you get that mass real estate on the big screen, and you also get that co-viewership for that enhanced added value reach as well. And then drilling down just a little bit further, Hulu's audience, again, uniques are now at 36 million, and we're seeing that trend just continue to increase. I think that's with the explosion of connected TVs, but then also our content offerings with originals and exclusives, and then also our distribution partnerships. So we're working with Spotify, Sprint to create these media bundles that make everything more accessible. And then drilling down just a little bit further, Hulu's unique age or median age is 31, and you'll see in comparison to traditional TV, broadcast is 55, cable is 48, and DVR is 43. So even at that lowest age group, there's still a huge delta of what that young age you can hit. So Hulu helps get those cord cutters, but also that younger audience, so you can have that holistic package there. Lastly on my portion, just some local value propositions, which will still be come in hand with advanced TV. We have geo-targeting, so we can go all the way down to zip codes and radius to make sure you're hitting that most applicable audience. We also have category separation to make sure you're not diluting your message if you're running next to a competitor, so we just avoid that. We have a brand safe environment, which is huge right now. Fair rotations of ads, so we look at local and national the same. We don't prioritize one over the other. Behavioral targeting we can implement, and this is on connected TVs as well, so you can hit that lower hanging fruit. And then we also have 100% ad completion rate, so a user has to watch the full video before we charge for that, and that's to maximize value and ensure you're getting that user dwell time. And also just to point out, Hulu compared to traditional TV only runs about 90 second commercials within a break versus the traditional TV of 5 to 6 minutes. And now I will pass it over to Joe.
Okay, cool. So, you know, programmatic at Hulu is called Advanced TV, and it's for a couple different reasons. You know, really, we launched our programmatic offering in December of 2015, and when we kind of took it out to the marketplace, I think what we noticed was most people are looking at programmatic as kind of a more efficient way to buy, you know, unsold inventory across, you know, display and desktop inventory. And so, as Clara mentioned, almost 80% of our inventory is consumed on a connected TV device. We kind of had to shift and change branding to go with Advanced TV since, you know, most of our inventory is being consumed there. And then also, to stay in line with some of our other Hulu value propositions, we wanted to make sure that our programmatic offering aligned with all of those things. So, here's the top five reasons that our Advanced TV offering drives results for advertisers. One, Advanced TV on Hulu addresses many advertisers' concerns, including running, of course, on a safe environment, no fraud, high viewability. Inventory bought via Advanced TV is identical to inventory bought via direct buy. So that means that advertisers receive premium placement within premium content, right? So within those pods, you guys are serving your ads in programmatic the same way a direct buy would be serving their ads. Hulu's audience insights allow for more effective targeting, which leads to delivering the right ad to the right user at the right time, and of course, on the right device. And then transacting Advanced TV deals directly with Hulu's sales team allows for quality. So Clara's the only one who's allowed to sell, well, to you all, anyway. That's the only one that's allowed to sell Hulu's inventory, right? We don't have any third parties that are reselling our inventory, right? We wanna make sure that we have quality control there. And then lastly, Hulu's Advanced TV competes directly with a direct buy. So we own our own ad system, our own ad server. We're not using a commercial ad server. So what that means is we have the ability to control what inventory is available within our different product offerings. And specifically with Advanced TV, we want to make sure that we have all the same inventory available to buyers who are buying programmatically through the Advanced TV offering, as well as people buying through our direct buys. All right, so Hudu Automation Data and Measurement Overview. So this is really kind of a holistic view of our advanced TV offering. Really, so for buyers who want to buy via the automated pipes, right through a DSP or any of the vendors, you know, Trade Desk is in the room, so they're an approved DSP of ours. We have two different deal types that you're able to transact on within the automation. So we have the automated guaranteed deal type, which allows for campaign insights, data matching, and audience visibility. We also have the unreserved deal type, which allows you to do optimization control, make data-driven decisions, and then you have the choice on whether or not you're going to accept an impression. And then, of course, with data targeting, we have the ability to take data from online sources or offline sources. So for people who are used to buying digitally through cookie environments, we are able to receive cookie data via our relationship with Oracle and Glukai. And then anyone who's used to buying like through addressable markets, through the, you know, if you're used to buying through MVPDs, like the Dishes and DirecTVs of the world, we're also able to take data in those ways as well, through our relationship with LiveRamp and Axiom. And lastly, measurement. We have a number of different offerings we have for measurement. We have viewability. So with Moat, we use Moat for our viewability metrics. We have over 93% viewable, which is way higher than industry standards. With post-campaign attribution, also better known as business results on Hulu, we have a number of different partnerships that we have here as well. And then lastly, what you can't see is we have some audience validation through Comscore and Nielsen DAR as well. And let's talk a little bit about our data-driven offering. So, you know, as many of you probably know, digital has done well at embracing data, right? Cookie data has been used for at least 6 or 7 years to, you know, those ads that follow you around the internet, right? To be able to target people based on their activity online. And then, of course, the world of TV is also moving more towards being able to offer data more frequently. And then since Hulu is the, we like to say, is the best of digital TV, we want to make sure that we can service our clients in both of these arenas, right? So as I mentioned, we have our DMP Oracle to allow for buyers who use cookie data to make data-driven decisions and purchases. And then we also have our relationship with Axiom for people who use offline data to make purchases and decisions. And so really, you know, because Hulu is, you know, like I said, 80% in the living room, we had to make sure that we were able to service clients in a way that allows them to, who still use cookies to make purchases, to be able to target across all devices, and then also be able to find a way to allow any buyers who are buying Hulu inventory to be able to use their data to target on Hulu. And so, really, what we're trying to say here is we've been able to use some of our relationships with Axiom, Experian, and the like to be able to take offline data and target on Hulu. But more importantly, we have our own internal device graph that allows us to take cookie data and target it across device. So, in a world that's a cookie-less world, especially with Safari not having cookies and a number of other browsers and changes happening in that environment, wanted to make sure that we can still be able to target on a per user basis as opposed to by cookies. And then talk a little bit about our automated buying. So really, automated buying on advanced TV is about taking your data and your targeting, you know, sending that to Hulu, and then we're targeting across all different devices. It's really what this slide illustrates. And then lastly, the two deal types that we talked about before. Just wanted to make mention that in these two deal types, you can use data in both of the deal types, but they are used differently. So in our automated guaranteed deal type, we're actually able to use deterministic data targeting, as I kind of mentioned previously, to be able to target individual users on across devices. And so what you would do there is share your data with us beforehand. So like I said, if it's offline data or if it's online data, we're able to take that and we can actually forecast inventory based on your target and target those people. And so again, campaign insights, data matching, and audience visibility are really some of the benefits of the automated guaranteed deal type. And then in the unreserved fixed deal type, really you're able to use your data to make data-driven decisions. So you can upload that data into the DSP or any of the other platforms and make decisions on whether or not you're going to accept the impression if it matches your targeting within that platform. And then just some of the rules of engagement for our advanced TV offering that really sets us apart from some of the others out there is one, advanced TV deals must be sourced through a WHO AE, again, Clara in this instance. All pricing is static and predetermined, so we don't have kind of a exchange or a marketplace where people are bidding against each other. It's predetermined pricing and static. That's all determined with Clara, in this case, as I mentioned before, prior to going live. It's one deal ID to one campaign and not a marketplace. Again, because we offer pod exclusivity, we want to make sure that we're able to control for that. And so for every campaign, we do one deal ID. And then, as I mentioned, it's not a biddable environment where you have to compete with others and there's a floor. And that is it. Should we take questions?
Let's do questions on that.
Thank you, guys. My name is Blake Simon, Senior Director of Business Development at the Trade Desk. I lead the sales team at the Pacific Northwest region out of our San Francisco office. Just before I go into sort of the meat of my presentation, which is obviously going to be about TV and programmatic and more of sort of a high level sort of the meat that Hulu went into, just want to give you guys a little background on the Trade Desk. Those of you who maybe aren't as familiar with us as some other folks, the Trade Desk was actually founded in 2009. We've had really a meteoric rise since then, a lot of success. We went public in 2016, and actually today we're the largest independent demand-side platform, or DSP, in the marketplace. And we really built a platform to help enable marketers and agencies like Poynt to be able to transact and buy media in a programmatic fashion. So what we're really razor-focused on today is really, again, building out a transparent omni-channel platform that allows marketers to be able to reach their audiences across all channels and all devices. One of those channels that we're very bullish on and putting a lot of our resources behind, specifically in the past year and a half, is connected television. We see, like many of you do today, that a lot of people are cutting the cord and they're leaving their cable and TV subscriptions. They're viewing more TV content across streaming devices and connected television. And we really feel that programmatic is really the best avenue to reach those audiences for marketers to really see the best return on their investment. So before we get into CTV, I just want to make sure we're all on the same page in terms of what programmatic is. And I think a lot of people use it differently. Some people have different definitions of it. But being one of the leaders in the programmatic space, just kind of want to run through this with you real quick. So programmatic buying is a process of buying media in a fashion through digital platforms. Unlike, you know, obviously traditional buying where it's insertion order based, very manual, all prior programmatic buying is done via automation and done in a way where it's usually via real-time auction, very similar to how financial stocks are traded today. But the real thing to know about programmatic more than anything else is that it really gives the advertiser or the buyer the power to choose what impressions they want as opposed to the publisher. So programmatic at its core and its simplest form is really all about choice. It really empowers the advertiser to choose what impressions they want and to pay the price they deem worthwhile for those impressions. So it really lends itself to true price discovery. If you read any major economist or listen to any major economist, you'll understand that the true one of the true forms of a healthy marketplace is price discovery, and price discovery is obviously understanding the value of any good or service. So instead of with traditional buying, instead of paying for the first five impressions that you see with programmatic advertising, you're actually able to choose the five impressions that you want and pay the price that you deem that those are worthwhile. I think Joe actually said in his presentation, but a phrase you hear a lot when it comes to programmatic buying, right price for the right impression at the right time at the right site. I'm sure if you guys have ever been pitched by ad tech vendors, you guys probably hear that ad nauseum. But the phrase really does ring true when it's executed correctly. And the reason why is because it delivers the best ROI for marketers. And obviously, marketers today have a very tough job. Their audiences are across all different channels, all different devices, across all different locations, across all different devices and apps. So it's paramount that they have the choice to be actual, to decide exactly where they want to target their audience, how they want to message them, or what frequency they want to message them, and make sure that's at the right price. Okay, to the charts portion of the presentation. I promise this won't be too long, but tells a good story, as Joe and the whole team did as well, in terms of where really global media consumption is going. And as all of us, I think know at this point, global media consumption is at an all-time high. This chart specifically shows the media consumption across all different generations, from traditional baby boomers to Gen Xers to millennials and Gen Zers. And to no surprise, the millennials and Gen Zers are consuming media across all different devices and channels more so than anybody else, especially when it comes to those of the older generation. And the main channel that they're consuming more than any others is really streaming video, TV, or movies, and online. So this is obviously in stark contrast to obviously traditional television and how folks of the older generation have consumed media for a number of years. And to take TV, for example, to dive a little bit deeper into that, across, this is a survey done over 3,000 participants across all different countries for the ages of 18 to 24, and as you can see, pretty apparent here, TV is declining, for the last 7 years for this demographic.
Well, can I ask you a question?
Yeah, sure.
Based on what you've shown there about millennials, difference between B2C versus B2B in connected TV. Is there a greater impact in the B2C environment?
I don't have any specific charts that point to that per se. Mm-hmm. But I think it should be known that this is sort of a generality of where these folks are actually consuming media. So I mean, if the general audience is moving towards more of a connected television, it's fair to say that those folks who work at those companies would probably obviously be consuming media, or consuming more media in connected television as opposed to traditional. So really, when it comes to connected television and advertising and television in general, I think it's fair to say at this point, if you do not have a connected TV strategy, if you're not advertising on CTV, you're potentially missing out on half of the audience that is out there. This chart shows how folks consume TV on traditional television, again, for the different generations. As you can see here, 54% still consume on traditional TV, the other half, or 46%, or across connected television devices, and those devices being broken up by smart TVs, OTT devices, and gaming consoles. So again, if you're not advertising connected television, you risk losing out on a huge generation of folks. Your next brand ambassadors, really for the next 30 or 40 years, who are the ones who are gonna be consuming media content different than the way they did previous generations. So it's paramount, as you're putting together your media strategy, you have something around connected television to either get ahead of the curve or at least be thinking about it going forward.
How do you help a digital marketing manager convince their boss that, hey, this is the time, maybe we've never done any TV advertising before, but now to move in this direction?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. It's something that I think, we still struggle with a little bit, but what it comes down to is really understanding, and then my presentation is going to go into this a little bit, but really understanding that the great thing about connected television is that you're really mirroring the experience that you have in digital, and you're able to measure it and attribute those conversions the same way that you are in digital experience that you can't do in linear television. That's really the power of CTV, is that you're using the medium of television, which is really the most powerful and impactful advertising medium that we've ever had, and now you have all the buttons you can push, all the data you can push that you can in digital, now in a TV environment. So that's really the power, and that's kind of what I'm going to get into here, sort of in the next couple slides. So what is connected television? All of us sort of have different definitions. There's a number of different TV terms we've heard today, which is linear TV, addressable TV, and then advanced TV, as a Hulu folks like to call it. But in terms of connected TV, as it pertains to the Trade Desk, and I think the way we talk about it with our inventory partners, it's really, we're talking about internet-connected TV streaming content across the biggest screens in the home. So when you think about it, your smart TVs, your Samsung, your LG televisions, your OTT devices, these are your Rokus, your Apple TVs, your gaming consoles, Xboxes, PlayStations, and of course your sticks like Google Chromecast, and Amazon Fires. Now I do want to specifically point out that when we're talking about connected television advertising, we're not talking about putting a display ad on a gaming console, or putting a video ad next to user-generated content, i.e. YouTube. This is professional video ads across across, you know, professional video ads, across professional content that really replicates basically the experience that consumers have today in traditional television with commercials. I always like this slide just to kind of give you a sense of the CTV landscape and sort of the different ways you can buy inventory as an advertiser or marketer. So on the left, you have your devices. These are, again, your Rokus, your Chromecast, your Apple TVs. And these are the apps and hardware that deliver film and TV content, you know, via an internet-connected TV without having to subscribe like you would for a cable or a satellite subscription. It's obviously just a hardware that you plug into your television and it unleashes all different types of valuable content. Then you have your apps. You have your multi-channel video program distributors or MVPDs. These are probably the most similar to viewing television as you would on sort of your traditional television devices, where it's a programming of different channels. You can go and select all the different options that you have at your disposal, and it's usually for a monthly subscription fee. Then you have your SVODs, like our friends at Hulu, subscription videos on demand, where it's a service that gives you unlimited access to a wide variety of premium content for a flat monthly rate. And then you have your app networks, which are very similar to ad networks, sort of in the display and traditional digital display space, where it's sort of a collection of all different types of television inventory. And finally, you have your apps, which is, you know, the end content creators, your CBSs, your Fox, your Turners, and you can actually buy through them directly as well. There's a number of different ways you can purchase inventory or get access to inventory in a connected TV or OTT environment. I think the main thing to take away here is that all of this is premium, all of this is brand safe, so it's a great avenue to really grow brand awareness or drive performance for a specific campaign. So when you marry CTV to programmatic advertising, you really get the best of both worlds, and you get an extremely powerful combination. With CTV, you get a brand safe, premium environment that's showing ads across the most impactful medium, advertising medium that's ever known to man, which is television. And then with programmatic, you get that precise targeting, be able to target that specific audience that you want to hit, and you have control of the frequency of the ads you serve, the message that you want to send, as well as the price. And all this is data-driven. It's all driven by either first, second, or third-party data. And now, since it's an internet-connected environment, you're able to do this across devices, from a television set to a mobile device to a desktop. So how is this all done? So when it comes specifically to audience buying, and I should sort of set the stage, a little bit of a sales pitch here. This can all be done within the Trade Desk. I can't speak to other DSPs. But in terms of our technology, this is something that's all available as I kind of run through the different options here. But as we know, when it comes to our audience targeting, it's extremely limited within linear TV. You know, we can, it's more of a spray and pray approach where you're targeting a demo. You can do some day parting in some aspects, but for the most part, it's extremely limited. The great thing about digital is that we can get very granular with our targeting. We have insights based off of that data in terms of what the different assets or different attributes are of every single consumer. And since CTV has the same pipes as digital, you're obviously able to replicate that. So now you can target folks based off of demo, household income, what they're in market for, and all different types of data points you're able to gather. And the great thing about this is that it eliminates the waste that you get with linear television. I'm sure all of us at some point have been watching television and we see the same ad over and over again. Not only is it extremely annoying, but it's a terrible brand experience. And the most important thing is that it's actually wasting ad dollars. With CTV, you're able to negate all this. And CTV via programmatic. So you're able to find that unique audience and make sure you target them and make sure that your media dollars are being spent and actually hitting consumers. And more than anything else, it's a great brand experience for the consumer. So as mentioned, marketers are able to implement cross-device with CTV as well, based off of the connection on the internet. So this obviously means now that you get more visibility into the entire customer journey, including your television set. So as consumers are moving from device to device, you actually have visibility now when your ads are being shown, where they're being shown. So that, of course, then informs your strategy so that you can plan accordingly. Of course, if you don't know what's happening with those ads, then it really doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And so the great thing now is we're now able to attribute all types of metrics within connected television, everything from VCR, video completion rate, to sales, conversions, to cost per completed view, to unique reach. Whatever metric is important to your business, you're able to see that now in connected television. And this obviously informs you exactly now. You will see exactly where the best performing channels are, and obviously shift your media dollars to those best performing channels to make sure that you're creating a holistic marketing strategy as opposed to a channel-based strategy to really drive the best performance or best awareness for your specific brand. Also, if you want to use connected television to compare it to your linear TV linear TV strategy, we offer Nielsen connected TV reporting. This is something you can run to measure things like GRPs and reach, which is obviously commonly measured within linear TV buys to understand exactly how connected television relates to linear television. I should set some expectations. We run a lot of these types of studies for our clients. And what you will see is because the budgets in linear television are still so much more massive compared to connected television, and the reach is still much higher in linear television, the reach in GRPs, because GRPs is reach times frequency, is going to be higher. But what you are going to see is the power of programmatic. What these studies usually show, and we've seen this across the board, is that on-target percentage in terms of the audience we're hitting is 5 to 10x higher, and the frequency that we're hitting is 5 to 10x lower. So that means we're being much more efficient and less wasteful with our advertiser dollars and CTV, and we're also seeing incremental reach within the connected television environment. So you are able to reach a unique audience within CTV, which is obviously extremely powerful and a nice tale you can go back and tell your linear TV buyers about what the power of connected television. So finally, just want to close and just give you guys just sort of some thought starters around some connected TV strategies you guys can take back as you're thinking about potentially implementing this, whether it be for your brand, your agency, or whoever it may be. So the first, a real easy one, is folks who are already buying, on digital via video. Your metrics are, it could be VCR. You can implement CTV as a way to obviously extend that audience from video into CTV. Not to mention bump the VCR rate up pretty significantly, which because obviously it's most of it's addressable and non-skippable inventory. Additionally, we have sort of the full funnel journey, as we like to call it. This is great for DR or e-commerce focused brands. Who do a great job in the lower part of the funnel in terms of driving sales, especially through retargeting, but they're trying to find a cost-efficient and impactful manner at the upper part of the funnel to really reach an audience. And no medium is better than connected television in terms of driving that impact. So it's a great way to layer on connected television with your DR efforts to really reach people and drive them down to the funnel. And obviously now you can track them by seeing which impressions then contributed to sales or whatever metrics you guys are measuring against. And then finally, we have sort of traditional TV extension. These are for brands who, again, really depend on their awareness through sort of the traditional way of television, extending that into a new audience in a connected TV and reaching those people in a CTV environment to increase that reach as more folks are cutting their cord, or maybe some folks who cord never, as we call them, who never even use linear television. And obviously, we recommend using sort of a Nielsen study run alongside this to really understand the power to buy, inform your strategy accordingly. So that's it for me.
Cool. Yeah. Thanks, Blake. Awesome. So Joe and Blake did a great job giving an overview of what connected TV is versus advanced TV and linear, but I kind of wanted to bring it back to seeing how connected TV ties into an overall customer journey. So in this specific example, a connected TV ad was the first interaction that a user had with a brand. But that wasn't the only interaction that was needed for that user to actually make a purchase. It took another action with a Google search and maybe someone clicking on a search ad. And then once they actually go to a website, we can retarget with a banner ad. And this is something that I see with a lot of the campaigns that I run with my team, is it takes at least two different interactions before someone actually makes a purchase. And I've even seen some conversion paths with 10 different interactions. And connected TV can play into that journey with either introducing a brand or re-engaging a user, maybe even in the middle of a journey. And now I just want to talk a little bit about what connected TV strategy I would recommend starting with. So first, I think with any marketing campaign, it's important to try and figure out how you're going to reach your audience. What's great about connected TV is you have the control over what device you're using to engage your user and on what network and in what area that your target market is. So if you find that your audience is engaging the most on an Xbox and on Hulu, you can focus more of your budget on Hulu and on Xbox, and this just maximizes your ad dollars that you have. And these are some of the things, and Blake touched on this a little bit, but these are things that are, I think, possible for the very first time with a TV advertising campaign. You're able to leverage first-party data, third-party data, if someone's in market for a product, if someone has an affinity for a certain product or brand, and you're also able to control how many times a user will see your ad across multiple devices. And this eliminates a lot of wasted impressions and wasted ad dollars. Second, I think it's really important to consolidate all of your media buys. Google Insights did a study with Nielsen last year that both brands and agencies save 29% more of their time if they consolidate all of their different buys in one platform. But in addition to consolidation being efficient, it's also more effective. So when you combine all of your different buys, let's say from Xfinity, from Hulu, from Fox, your budget then becomes fluid between all of those different media buys. So if you see, for example, that you are seeing more engagement from your audience on Hulu, in real time, you can segment more of your total budget to Hulu. In addition, you also have access to deals that are already pre-curated. So back in the day, you would have to reach out to Xfinity to create different media buys for a quarter or for a year. And you'd have to pre-plan all of that deal buying. But now that these deals are available in a platform, and that saves your team time and resources with reaching out to the right contact at Xfinity or Hulu. And something else that I think is really important with consolidation is being able to measure engagement from all of your different buys in one place. So you can compare performance apples to apples and then segment more budget towards the buys that are creating more engagement for your brand. And this is, in optimizing to goals is something that I think is a huge benefit of connected TV, because this isn't something that's possible with traditional or linear TV. So you're actually able to optimize your campaign towards your campaign objective, whether that be reach. If you are launching a new product and you want to reach as many different people as possible, you can lower your frequency cap. Or if it's completion rate, you can focus more of your budget on the videos that people are actually completing. And there are still ways to measure bottom line sales, like Blake mentioned. And I do want to bring this slide up, not because I love it or anything, but I think this is really good to focus on when you're looking at how to optimize your connected TV campaigns. You really want to leverage the data that you have available to create a user experience across devices. And lastly, I think it's really important to know how to measure the success of your TV campaign. And I think this is something that a lot of marketers struggle with, since TV is a brand awareness strategy. So how do you measure if your million-dollar TV campaign actually impacted your program as a whole? And I think it's really important to not just look at your campaign metrics, but look at other metrics that you're using, like using Google Analytics and looking at how traffic has been increasing or decreasing after you've launched your connected TV campaign. Also, with one campaign that we ran a few months ago, we actually saw a lift in total number of branded searches that were happening. And then our search team was able to capitalize on that increase in traffic. And lastly, you can still look at if there's a lift in offline sales as well as online sales, and see how this is connected with your campaigns that you're running. So next steps, I think the first piece is figuring out if you have any video assets that you can utilize for TV, and figure out if they are able to be in an environment that is engaging with the audience that you're reaching, and also connecting that video asset back to your campaign objective. And also, that brings me to my next point, which is trying to figure out what your main objective and goal is for the campaign. If you do want a connected TV campaign to be more focused on sales, then that shifts your strategy to using connected TV with a direct response strategy. So using it as a form of retargeting versus using it as a form of engagement. I also think it's important to know what partners you want to use and what different types of media you want to use in your campaign. Like I mentioned with the user experience, you can use TV in conjunction with online radio ads that you're using. So figuring out what types of media you want to use and how you want to connect them together can help you get started. And lastly, if you do have the resources in-house, I would recommend reaching out to a platform that can consolidate all of your media buys for you, because it makes your campaign that much more effective. And if you don't, I would suggest reaching out to an agency that has programmatic experience and is using their platform self-service. So you know what levers they're making, and you're able to ask them questions and have them be transparent with you throughout the entire process. But if you are thinking about running a connected TV campaign but you don't know where to start, I would be more than happy to have a conversation with you. This is my email, but also on LinkedIn. Cool. And then I think we have a few minutes left for questions.
So say someone wants to start shifting budget, testing it out, what would you think like a entry-level budget would be, just to kind of dip their toes in the water?
So what's great about programmatic in general is you can use
what's great about programmatic?
Yeah, is you can start off with a smaller budget and see what performance and engagement looks like, and then you can increase your budget from there. So if you want to start off with a 10K test budget, you can. And you can see how that budget's affecting a small portion of your program, and then expand upon performance.
Cool.
Yes.
So if you did do a test, would you recommend doing it for like a time period, trying to measure the lift in your other channels? Or like if you're doing a test and you see that it's performing in some way, just keep it running? Like what? Is it better to like control the environment, do the test, stop it, measure lift, and then go again?
So since TV in general is more of a longer term strategy, I'd recommend running the test for at least 3 months, so you can look at how it's not only affecting your campaign that you're running, but other numbers in your company, like the total leads that the sales team is seeing. And I think it takes about 3-ish months to do that, at least. Yes?
Let's just say I have one video asset. Is that cool to run with, or is there a certain minimum that you'd recommend so people, you know, don't get sick of whatever it is you're running?
Yeah. I think that there's always room to test to see which message is resonating the best with your audience, and that's why I would recommend to have 3 different messages, and then you can really hone in on the one that's the most engaging with your audience.
Go going back to budget, when you talked about the 10K initial start, how much of that budget would you dedicate specifically to Connected TV?
I would, at first, if we haven't run Connected TV with your brand before, I would allocate all of the 10K towards Connected TV, and I would try to connect that with any other display campaigns that you're running.
And any rough idea how many impressions that would buy or broadcast?
Yeah, so it really depends on the publisher, but with Connected TV, a lot of the CPMs are fixed, and so the cost per impression ranges from $15 to $25.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got a similar question. Blake mentioned in some of his stats there about like 69% of people still watching TV, so that should I be looking to take 31% of that budget and moving it towards Connected TV, or how does that sort of transition, and is that opportunity best placed? I'm sort of looking at the two solutions. Is it Hulu in one sense, or how do I sort of use the best of both worlds to really connect with the right people with that budget?
yeah, no, it's a great question. I think it's something that we're still kind of struggling with today. And we're actually trying to run back end metrics to really understand, you know, what is that unique reach look like, and what on Connected Television, what specific budget should I actually put towards CTV? What's the data behind it? But I mean, generally speaking, I think what you want to do is to Priya's point, is test it out, see how it performs, how it affects some of the other channels you're in. And at that point, you can get a better sense of, and if you run like a Nielsen study, for instance, you can actually see, get some numbers around like what that reach is, what that percentage of audience you're reaching. Then you can get a better sense of like how much budget should be going towards Connected TV along with linear. Now, I'm not saying like don't advertise in linear. I mean, obviously, being that we don't work in linear, I would say give everything to CTV in a perfect world. But I mean, I think linear television obviously is still extremely impactful. So you do want to advertise linear television. I don't think you want to go away from that, especially if it's a strategy of yours. I think more than anything else, that there is a huge audience now in Connected Television. You have to have a strategy around it. You have to be thinking about it, and you have to be putting some sort of budget around that, and test it out. And I think once you test it out, you'll be able to have a lot of metrics behind you to understand exactly, you know, where I can kind of, you know, shape my budget towards all different channels, especially when it comes like digital, that sort of thing. So.
Cool.
And I would just add to that too. I think it also would depend on the demo that you do want to hit. So I think it would be like potential to heavy up if you are going after those millennials on Connected TVs, but still utilizing linear first. If you're going after that older audience, then, you know, that's where you can heavy up a little bit more on linear versus Connected TVs. I think it's that demo again there.
Good point. Gotcha. Yeah. Thanks.
Cool. Any others?
I have one. This might be a Hulu or a Trade Desk. In your experience, what industries have been early adopters of CTV, and which ones have been more resistant?
Yeah, I'm just thinking real quick. No, great question. I would say, gosh, in terms of like QSR and auto are some of our top categories, and we've seen those really get on board, and I think also it's speaking to the demo that they want to hit. I think some of the harder, slower ones, it's not necessarily just a vertical, but it's also people that have been in the traditional space for a long time. So like some of the long existing retail, those have been like more conversations and frequency we've had to have to get them out of that traditional mindset and understand the value of Connected TV. So I think it's, I would say verticals that have been most successful in transferring over is QSR, auto, some of those top categories that we actually see on TV, and some of those challenging ones are just more of the older school companies that have been around for a long time, such as some retail companies.
Yeah, I would echo that too. I mean, I think it's the same challenge you have with trying to convince folks to use more upper funnel tactics, right? So the folks who are already comfortable with upper funnel advertising, you know, CPG companies, telecom companies, QSRs, auto, we see a lot of folks who are used to be comfortable to see television and say, hey, I got a huge budget, I'll test a little bit in this kind of television. It's the retail folks, the DR folks that are still, I think, struggling to understand the value, but at the same time, when you can now that you can marry it back with metrics, I think it's a much easier conversation to have, and it's just kind of a mindset more than anything else. You're just trying to change internally.
Thanks.
Kind of going to the generational data that you guys put up about, you know, the millennials and Gen Z and Gen X and boomers. Don't you think that's that's because maybe Gen Zs have a lot more time than boomers to watch streaming TV?
Yeah, no,
that market gets older, it might shift?
Could be, but I think I would argue that it's really the way that the industry is going now. I mean, a lot of folks grow my son, who's 3 years old, like, he doesn't watch a lot of television, but all he knows is like YouTube, and like, mm-hmm. I want to watch, you know, Moana, and I want to watch it now, you know. So they haven't grown up when there's all these different channels that you're forced to watch, you know, the CBS Evening News at 5:30, right? Like, they're all about on demand, they're all about apps, and they're all about watching it whenever they want. I think that's where the mind shift kind of changes. That's where consumers are going. I think that's why you see the difference. It's not, I mean, sure, they probably do have more time on their hands, like, especially if they're in college or whatnot, but mm-hmm. I think it's more that the baby boomers grew up in a generation, as did I, where everything was via cable and satellite TV subscriptions. That's all you knew. So it's like anything else, it just takes a little bit longer to.
Yeah, and I was going to say, at Hulu, we always say, you don't grow into old media, so tomorrow, if I'm incredibly smart, I probably won't pick up a newspaper. I'll probably go on my apps and see the, you know, the skim and what's trending right now. So it's just, I think, the being an early adopter with those younger generations, and then that, the fact that you don't grow into old media.
Yeah, and I would just echo that, and maybe even parallel that with, like, home phones,
mm-hmm.
right? When you think about people in college, what their activity is in college, and then when they graduate, they kind of continue that. You'll go to most millennials or Gen Z's houses and they don't have
home
lights. But maybe some of the more mature folks might have.
Yes.
This is for any of you. What do you think is the most common mistake that advertisers make when they launch or run a CTV campaign?
I'll take that. so I think the biggest struggle is having the wrong expectations about what a CTV campaign will provide to their program. And a lot of advertisers who are running digital are very used to looking at things in a last touch model, especially if they're running a search campaign. And since connected TV is bought through a programmatic platform and it's still digital, I think sometimes they're expecting the same bottom line results. But with connected TV, like I said, it's not just about the campaign metrics, it's about looking at your other channels and how your connected TV campaign is affecting those.
More holistic approach.
Exactly. Yes.
This is for all three of you. Four of you, technically. I'm a digital marketing manager, online marketing manager, general marketing manager. And I go to this and I'm like, oh, this seems really cool. I'm doing a little bit of YouTube, but haven't started talking about the programmatic side of advertising yet. I have a one-on-one with my manager. I have 3 minutes to talk about why we should do this. What should I say?
Can I get more time?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think in terms of like programmatic, I think there's a couple of things that I think are important to mention, right? There's the measurement, there's use of data, and there's that control, right? So I think those are some of the things that we like to talk about when we're trying to explain programmatic more broadly. But yeah, if you have 3 minutes, that's where I'd go.
Okay.
Yeah. And specifically, and even on top of that, specifically with connected television, kind of what I talked about before, but it's a brand safe environment, premium inventory, non-skippable inventory. I mean, it's like the best of the best inventory out there,
mm-hmm.
As opposed to, as we know, there's been some issues with programmatic inventory where it's revenue inventory, had some fraud issues, that sort of thing. Like, CTV is the best of the best. And so I think you really should be, you know, obviously putting more dollars towards there. So.
This is a newbie question, but I'm going to go there. Going back to your buyer's journey slide and metrics, we can obviously measure lift, but can you connect the impression from CTV all the way through the rest of the cycle?
Yeah, actually with Trade Desk, you can. So with a campaign that actually just ended for one of my clients, we were able to measure the total number of leads that a TV ad drove.
Okay. Was that to a targeted list or?
So with this particular client, they are only serviceable in certain zip codes.
Uh-huh.
So we just focused our advertising budget in those zip codes and then also layered on behavioral targeting for people that are in market or would be in market for that product.
Thanks, guys. Before you all go, anybody interested in door prize time? Raffle, and I hate to break it to Pointed and Trade Desk folks, but you're not entered.
This is for the Amazon Echo Show and Cloud Cam bundle.